Good morning and welcome to Carey Baptist Church. My name is David Magowan. I'm one of the ministers here. It's good to welcome you to our service this morning. Welcome to any who are visitors with us. Let me just tell you about a couple of things that are happening. Next Sunday morning, 10:30 here at the chapel, we have a guest service. So that's a service that is really suitable for you maybe to invite somebody to come along. Maybe somebody that wants to find out more about the Christian faith. Somebody that's interested and wants to know what the Bible teaches. And so next Sunday, our guest service, answering the question, do I really need forgiveness? And James Muldoon, one of the other pastors here, will be speaking, God willing, next Sunday morning. And then on Tuesday, the 29th of March, so not this Tuesday, but the following Tuesday at 10 a.m., in the Oasis, there is a coffee morning for women. So if you're available, if you're around on Tuesday morning and you're a woman and you like coffee, I'm sure tea will be served also, hot cross buns, it's an Easter coffee morning, then you're very welcome to come to that. Well, we're here to worship God. We're going to do that as we sing praise to God, as we pray, as we hear God's word, the Bible, read and explained to us. And so we're going to start by singing. We're going to sing a setting of Psalm 84. So when the music starts, we'll stand to sing together. O Lord of hosts, how lovely is your dwelling place.
My soul.
Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this psalm that we have sung together. We thank you for the psalmist who longs that he might be in your presence. His heart and his flesh desire you, the living God. He longs to be with your people, engaged in worship of you. He longs to know the comfort and the strength of your power. He wants to feel safe and secure in the knowledge of your unfailing love towards him. He knows that you will strengthen him, that you will lead him, that you will provide for him, that you will enable him to persevere in faith. He desires that you might refresh his soul, that you would pour out that water of life into his parched spirit, that he might be revived, that he might be refreshed. He seeks your grace and he wants also to know your glory. And Father, we pray that the feelings of the psalmist might be echoed in our own lives, that we too, as we're gathered here this morning, might have that desire, that yearning, that we might meet with you, the living God, that we would recognize all that we owe to you, that we would recognize who you are, the God of greatness, the God of goodness, but the God of amazing grace. Father, we know that we in and of ourselves should not come near to you, should not draw near to you, a holy God, for we have sinned against you. But we thank you that in your grace, in that love that we do not deserve, you have sent your one and only Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, into the world, that he might be the Savior for sinners such as we. Father, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you that he is the one who reveals your grace, and he is the one that secures glory for those who trust in him. Father, we come this morning. We want to come with humble hearts. We want to come freely confessing our wrongdoing. We want to come trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, we pray that you would meet with us. We pray that you would assure us of your good purposes towards us. We pray that we would rest in the knowledge of your power and of your love. We pray that you would provide for us and for others. And Father, we pray that you would lead us on through this time of earthly pilgrimage until finally you bring us to be with you forever. Father, as we draw near to you, we pray that you would draw near to us. We pray that you would present yourself by your Spirit, that you would speak to us through your word, that you would encourage us in our faith and in our love and in our hope and in our joy. And Father, we pray then that we would go from here, renewed in our desire that we might honor you, that we might glorify you, and that we might make Christ known in the world. So Father, be with us, bless us, and help us now, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this morning we're continuing to look at Paul's letter written to the church in Colossae. And this morning we're looking at Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 to 6. And Jude Bullock is going to come and read those verses to us. Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 to 6.
Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. And pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly, as I should. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders, making the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone.
Thank you very much, Jude. Richard Webb is going to come and just explain to us how, as a church, we're responding to the crisis in Ukraine, and then Richard will lead us in prayer.
Well, I'm sure these colours are very familiar to many of us now, if they weren't a week or two ago. Perhaps some of us didn't even know where Ukraine was. Certainly growing up, I can remember not really having much understanding of what happened beyond Germany. It was just Russia, wasn't it? So anyway, this morning we're going to think a little bit about Ukraine and pray for Ukraine. And but before I do, I thought we'd just see this little video which Malcolm sent yesterday of a young friend called Alina. She's had a very long journey. We haven't got time to listen to all of that. We'll put it on Carey News for those that want to listen to that. We're just explaining just a little bit, just a sense of where she's at, and she's representative of hundreds of thousands of others. Some believers, obviously are not allowed, not believers, but where their lives are at this morning as we sit here. Thank you, Tim.
And what are your plans now?
As to my plans, ever in my life have been so much lost as I feel right now. Because when I was home, I think that I have had everything that I ever wanted. Yes, I have had my beloved job, and I have heard enough, more than enough for myself. And right now I think that I feel a little bit lost, because I am in a country that I don't really know, that I don't really know the laws, and I think that the most powerful dream and the most powerful thing for me is that I'm dreaming to come home in a month, I hope. Yes, but if it not will work, I pray for God's protection and that God show me the way. Yes, of course, I'd have to find a job, and I don't know. Yes, I don't know, but right now my parents, they are in Ukraine, and my brother is in Ukraine as well, and my brother-in-law. I don't know right now. I pray for God's protection and God show me the way. I know that everything requires your time, and in some time, like, the things will get stable. And I know that there will be a way. So no great plans yet.
Alina, thank you.
Well, there's Alina, a young woman who has left Ukraine, now in Germany. A family left in Ukraine. And so split family, not really sure what to do as yet. And it can be all very overwhelming, can't it? And yet we have an opportunity even here right now to do so much, even this morning, and to honor that great commandment. So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you, for this is, or sums up, the law and the prophets. So I just want to explain for a minute or two how we're going to focus our energy, attention, and prayers here at Carey, because there is so much that we can sort of dissipate our energy. So we're going to be very much focusing on two mission organizations. So CEP, Central Eurasian Partners. Last weekend, Malcolm, who you saw in the video, was with us, with Svetlana, who is also Ukrainian. So we'll be focusing on what they're doing and how they're involved in the crisis, the war. And also Ukraine Christian Ministries, which works more with churches in central Ukraine and what they're doing, as well as perhaps some personal stories from people around the church. So that'll be our focus in terms of organizations. And our activity is really going to be split into two things. I was thinking about just the other week, it's very easy to get so busy answering emails and sort of thinking about organizing things that you can squeeze out time to pray. And sometimes we think of prayer as perhaps being the only thing or the last thing we can do or the little thing we can do, but actually it's the best thing and the first thing that we should do. I was reading Habakkuk this week. I don't know if you've read Habakkuk recently. I hadn't read it for a long time. And Habakkuk starts with this prayer, and I don't know whether this perhaps sounds like your prayers for Ukraine this week. How long, Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen, or cry out to you violence, but you do not save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. The law is paralyzed And justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous, and justice is perverted. I don't know, does that sound a bit like your prayers this week? God, are you going to do something? Are you going to stop this war? Anyway, as Habakkuk goes through this prayer, God is very gracious to him and shows him many things. He shows him that God is above the nations. God is in control. God is even using the nations. And Habakkuk has a bit of a sort of a, I don't know, I don't get that, God. How are you using the nations in situations like this? But then he sees as well God's splendor, that God outlasts even the earth, not alone just nations. The mountains will crumble, but God will go on forever. And that there is a savior. And he ends up with a song. He starts from that prayer of despair, and he ends up with this song and says, even though in his situation is still bad, he says, though the fig tree does not bud, there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the sheepfold, no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer and enables me to tread the heights. So prayer. Prayer is our first priority and the best thing that we can all do. And then we'll be practical help as well. And we'll talk about that in a moment. And we're going to coordinate it through a team. I've been very privileged to be asked to be on that team. John and Ira Ward, as you can imagine, are on that team. David is Graham, to kind of keep any financial things in order, as well as bring his other broader wisdom to that. And Catherine Hillcote as well, who has obviously a lot of connection with the CEP group. So if you've got questions, perhaps ask any one of us, and we'll try and help you with that. And coordinate that activity. Do look out in Carey News and the prayer diary for prayer updates, anything specific. And again, we're going to try and sort of keep flowing, let that stuff flow through. And then in terms of funds for practical help, first of all, thank you everyone so much. The church here has been so generous already, and a lot of money has already flowed out to those two organizations that we spoke of. Even this morning, someone has come up to me and said, I've got some more money for a project. So thank you for what you have done and continue to do. This could go on some time, couldn't it? And we'll have to give and give again, I think, in this situation. Some of those funds will go out in terms of general ongoing needs that become aware, and as we sit down as a committee and perhaps work with the elders around what do we use the money for. But also, there was quite a groundswell of opinion here and in a lot of other churches last weekend and the days before, when Malcolm's been going around the country and made it known that actually there are certain specific things, particularly medical consumables, that are very hard to get in Ukraine right now and are desperately needed. Also hard to get those in Poland, even Germany. So there is a plan being hatched and has made good progress this week to fill a van of relevant stuff. Please don't just bring any stuff to the church, because we want to fill the van with things they really need right now, and that will largely be medical supplies. We can give you a list if you want to bring bits of that list, or if you want to just put money into the offering or whatever for that, that would be great. And we'll see over the next 2 weeks whether we get enough money. It's expensive filling a van with medical supplies, but we're working also with another church, another team in the north of England. And we're going to try and get two vans away. One is going from Scotland this week already. We're going to try and get two English vans away, but at least one. So if you can give towards that, that would be fantastic. In fact, one church member is already getting her school involved, or will be getting her school involved. So lots of things we can do around that. And just lastly, there hasn't been, through Malcolm at least as yet, a huge demand or questions of people saying, can I come? Has anyone got a home in the UK I can come to? I know some of you have been asking about that. But we will be looking at, as a church, sponsoring people to come, maybe in church accommodation or maybe in your home. And we have one person at the moment that may want to come. So we'll be looking at that this week. So those are the sort of practical things at the moment. Money to just send out for general use for the churches out there, and Malcolm and others helping people who are coming through their home and their town as refugees at the moment, sending a van load of supplies and maybe sponsoring people to come into the UK. Hope that's helpful to you. So let's turn some of that into prayer now. Let's pray. Oh Lord God, as we come before you this morning, we do recognize that you are Lord of all the earth. And it is our first and perhaps most natural cry to, like Habakkuk, to say, how long, O Lord, will you not step in, intervene? Will you not bring this violence and war to an end, this madness, this evil, this bloodshed, this misery, this suffering? And Father God, we do cry out for that this morning, knowing that you are a God of power and a God of mercy and a God of love. And we pray, Lord, in the mess that we're making, that, Lord, you would step in and restrain evil, and Lord, that good may come. And Lord God, we do pray as well today for peace. We pray for wisdom of governments, all governments, that Lord, there might be restraint on those who are pushing war, and there may be wisdom and on governments trying to bring about peace. We pray, Lord, for protection for people, Lord, they're in the war zone today, or traveling, or like Alina, dispersed around Europe with few friends and family around them. Lord God, we pray that you would step into those situations at a national level and at individual levels. Father God, we've been asked also to pray for salvation to come to people today in Ukraine and in Russia and across the world, of course. Father God, we know that what we see as just intense darkness and evil is often the time when we see you coming and triumphing. Lord, we see that, of course, most of all in the cross, when your own son was killed, when there was those 3 hours of darkness, when it seemed that everything had gone wrong from a human perspective, and yet it was that great triumph that brought us our salvation. And so, Father, we pray in this dark time in Ukraine and Russia and across Europe right now, that in the midst of this darkness, we might see spiritual triumph. We might see many people turning to you, many people asking questions, and many people finding their answers in you and your salvation. Lord God, even we pray that you might bring revival to Ukraine, to Russia, to the rest of Europe, to this needy land here too, that we might look to you, turn to you, and be saved. Father God, we pray for the churches in Ukraine this morning. Thank you that there are many believers there doing what they can do practically to show love. Lord, we hear of churches where are feeding people and transporting people from town to town as people flee the war, and that they are risking their lives at times to continue working on despite the air raid sirens around them. And Father God, we do pray that you would protect them and help them, Lord, even today, that in the churches of Ukraine there might be some semblance of what we're doing here, a time to pause and a time to worship you together, to pray, to hear your word. Lord, we pray that you would help them. And Lord, for the Christians that have been scattered across Europe, Lord God, we pray for them today that you would be close to them. We pray, Lord, that you would encourage them, Lord, that they would hold on to their faith, that you would meet their practical needs today. And Lord, even today, they would be finding other Christians that they can meet with. And Lord, we do pray, Lord, as perhaps for a time, or perhaps even for a long time, they're in different places, Lord, that they might see even how you might use them there for your glory and to be a blessing. And Father, too, as we think about practical things as well, we pray you give us great prudence and wisdom in how we use the resources. Thank you for the generosity of people. Thank you that you've opened our hearts and our wallets to respond to this. And Father God, we pray that you would help us to know when there is so much that we could do that is good, to know what the best things are to do. And Lord, if it's right that we get a vanload of supplies together, Lord, we pray that you would encourage us in that, by providing all the means that we need, of all the supplies and money that we need for that to happen. And Lord, we do pray for CEP and UCM, that you would give them wisdom in knowing how to use their time and energy and money right now. And we particularly pray for Malcolm and Jules, give them rest today, we pray, give them energy, give them wisdom, give them patience with their house being full with so many people who have so many needs and perhaps emotional needs as well as practical needs. an ear or two here in our church as she is in contact with so many people and seeking to encourage them and help them on their journeys, and all of us here, that you would help us to know what to do. Help us, Lord, first and foremost, to be much in prayer for this situation. And Lord, to see what else we can do, that your kingdom would be extended and you would be glorified. And Father God, this morning, even as we pray for this situation, which has so captured our minds and our hearts, even across the whole nation, across the whole world, Lord, we remember that there is so much trouble elsewhere as well today, in so many other places. And Lord, we know today that as we sit here worshiping freely together, there are Christians, hundreds of millions of Christians around the world today, suffering for their faith. And Lord, we would particularly just remember those of our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ who are Afghan this morning. We pray, Lord, for those who have fled their country. Lord God, we pray that they would settle well and they would settle amongst other believers and be encouraged in their faith. And Lord, that you would help them to build their lives. And Lord, we pray, Lord, for that they would stand firm in the gospel and be able to proclaim the gospel. And Lord, particularly as well for those who are still in Afghanistan, who has to hide their faith. Lord, protect them today, we pray. And Lord, may they be conscious of your presence and your help in all of their trouble, that they too, like Habakkuk, may be able to say, the sovereign Lord, the God of all the universe, the almighty God, is my strength, and he enables me. Father God, we thank you that we have the God of all the universe we can turn to at any time, but particularly at times like this, when we are so helpless and hopeless. Father God, we thank you that we have your help and your hope. And Lord God, we pray that we might see you glorified for your name's sake. Amen.
Thank you, Richard. We're going to sing. We're going to sing the song, My Heart is Filled with Thankfulness, perhaps even more so in these days. We are so thankful for all that we enjoy, even as we see others suffering in so many parts of the world. But thanking the Lord most of all for that gift of salvation, for the gift of his Son and his Spirit. So when the music starts, if you're able, then please do stand.
To him.
Well, it'd be great to have a Bible in front of you and to turn back to Colossians chapter 4. This morning we're looking at verses 2-6. Sometimes when you watch rugby or football or cricket on television, you see people in the crowd and they are really devoted to their team. You can tell that because they're wearing team shirts and scarves and hats. They're waving team flags. They've painted their faces, perhaps, in their team colors. Many of them may have traveled long distances at great expense in order to follow their team. What devotion. Now, people devote themselves to many things, not just to following team sport. People devote themselves to their children, to work, advancement in their career. People devote themselves to leisure, to exercise, to a hobby. People devote themselves to social media or to gaming. We can devote ourselves to all sorts of things. To devote yourself to something or to someone is to give much time and attention to a particular pursuit or to a particular person. People who are devoted are dedicated and committed and enthusiastic and persistent in their involvement. They don't give up easily. Well, this morning we're looking at Paul's letter written to the church in Colossae, and we've reached Colossians chapter 4, verses 2-6. And in this final section of what really is the main part of Paul's letter, Paul here writes to the church in Colossae about prayer and evangelism. Prayer and evangelism. Prayer is talking to God. Evangelism is talking to other people about God. And here Paul writes about prayer and evangelism. Paul begins this short section with a command. Look at verse 2. Paul says, "Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful." Be devoted or devote yourselves to prayer. Well, I wonder what you are devoted to. Here, Christians are to devote themselves to prayer. In other words, we are to pray regularly, and we're to be enthusiastic and committed and persistent in prayer. That's what it means to be devoted to something, doesn't it? We need this exhortation, don't we? Because it's all too easy not to be devoted to prayer. Yes, perhaps we pray, but probably we don't pray as often or as persistently or as widely as we should. I wonder how healthy is your prayer life. On a scale of 1 to 10, how do you rate your prayer life? I think very often our prayer can be irregular, it can be rushed, it can be routine, it can be predictable. Maybe we pray once or twice about something and then we stop. We give up far too easily. We don't persist in prayer. Or we pray earnestly only in a crisis or when we really want something for ourselves or maybe something for someone we love. Maybe our thoughts wander as we pray. We're not as focused as we should be. We're far too easily distracted when we pray. Maybe we struggle to know what to pray for. It seems perhaps that we seem to pray for the same things all the time. Let me just say that I'm speaking to myself as much as I'm speaking to others. Devote yourselves to prayer. And then Paul mentions two things that we should be as we devote ourselves to prayer. And if we are these two things that he mentions, then I think we will be more devoted to prayer. Firstly, Paul says, be watchful. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. But be watchful. That's the first thing that Paul mentions. Be attentive. Be alert as you pray. Look out and see what is happening around you. What is happening in your family life? What's happening amongst your friends? What's happening in the church? What's happening in the workplace where you are? What's happening in your place of study? What's happening in your community? Look around. Be attentive. Be watchful. See what's happening in the lives of others. See what's happening in the world around you. Be aware of dangers. Be aware also of opportunities. You see, the more that we're conscious of what is happening around us, the more we will be motivated to pray, and the better that we will know what we ought to pray for. Be watchful. Our prayer should be responsive to both need and opportunity. We need to look around us to see the needs that there are. We need to look around us and see what opportunities are before us. Be watchful in prayer. Devote yourselves to prayer, says Paul. Be watchful, but then secondly, be thankful as you pray. Be conscious of what God has done, what God has already done, and what God is presently doing in your life and in the lives of others. See, prayer is not just petition. Prayer is not just asking God for things, but prayer should also include praise and thanksgiving, as we rejoice in who God is and in all that God has done. As we entrust ourselves to God, as we hold on to God's promises, as we look to see God at work amongst us, we want to record God's goodness, God's faithfulness. We want to rejoice in God's grace. And of course, prayer is only possible because of what God has done for us. In and of ourselves, we have no right to approach God. God is holy. We are not. We are sinful. We have sinned against God. There is separation, alienation between us and God because of our sin. The only way in which we can approach God, the only way in which we can draw near to God, is because God, in his amazing love, in his grace, has sent his only Son, the Lord Jesus, into the world. And Jesus has come to reconcile sinful people to God. Jesus comes and he lives that perfect life that we cannot live ourselves. And Jesus goes willingly to the cross there to suffer and die, to take upon himself the penalty that sin deserves, to bear that penalty, that punishment in the place of others, so that as we put our trust and hope in the Lord Jesus, we can be forgiven all our sins. We're reconciled to God. We're brought into God's family, dearly loved, adopted children of God, and we can address him then as our Father. We can go to God, we can pray, and know that he will hear us, and he delights to hear us. And so we should be thankful when we pray. We're thankful because it's through the work that God has done that enables us even to come before him. And so we give him praise, and we give him thanks, not just for that work of salvation, but in so many other ways in which God is pouring good things into our lives. We want to be thankful and we want to be watchful as we devote ourselves to prayer. So as you pray, have an alert mind and a thankful heart. Have an alert mind and a thankful heart, because an alert mind and a thankful heart will encourage us to be more devoted to prayer. We want to pray more, then let's be watchful and let's be thankful. So Paul begins this little section by talking about prayer there in verse 2, urging us, encouraging us, commanding us, directing us to devote ourselves to prayer. But then Paul goes on in verses 3 and 4 to ask for prayer for himself and his co-workers. Look at verses 3 and 4. Paul says this, "And pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should." Paul has been talking about prayer. Now he's talking about evangelism. He's actually talking about prayer for evangelism, prayer for his ministry and the ministry of his colleagues as they are traveling and seeking to make the good news of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ known to others. And I think here in verses 3 and 4, Paul is suggesting three ways in which we can pray for evangelism. Firstly, we can pray for people who proclaim the gospel. Paul here asks for prayer for himself and his co-laborers as they proclaim the gospel. And so we can pray for pastors and evangelists and mission partners who are called by God to actively proclaim the good news of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. Pray for those who are proclaiming the gospel. So on Sundays, you could pray for those who are preaching in this church and in other churches. On Mondays, you could pray for our mission partners, those whom we have sent to to bring the good news, the gospel, to others. But we can also pray for those who are serving in church ministries, those who are making the gospel known through those regular activities in the church. So on Tuesdays, you could pray for the person speaking at football. On Wednesdays, you could pray for Helen Yule, our international worker, as she leads the Bible lesson at Bridges, our English language school. Or on Wednesdays, you could also pray for the person who's speaking at our seniors' lunch. On Thursdays, you could pray for those who are leading the life group or those who are speaking at the church-wide prayer meeting. On Fridays, you could pray for those who are speaking to children and young people in the various groups that meet, for those who are speaking once a month at the community night at the Oasis. We can also pray for one another as we have opportunity to proclaim the gospel to others, that we might faithfully and boldly proclaim the gospel in the various places where God has put us, where we are to be witnesses for the Lord Jesus Christ. And so on Saturdays, you could pray that every Christian will be encouraged and equipped for worship, work, and witness in the week that lies ahead. There's a week worth of prayers as we pray for those who proclaim the gospel. Paul here asks for prayer as he proclaims the gospel. Let's pray for those who are proclaiming the gospel in so many different ways, so many different contexts, to so many different people. But secondly, verses 3 and 4, we can pray for God to give people gospel opportunities. Pray for God to give people gospel opportunities. In verse 3 here, Paul asks the church in Colossae to pray specifically that God will give him and his co-workers opportunities to speak to others about Jesus. How does he put it? He says, pray that God would open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ for which I am in chains. Paul is writing from prison. Isn't it really interesting that the door that Paul wants them to pray would open is not the door of his prison cell, but rather he wants them to pray that God would open a door of gospel opportunity, that he and others might be able to proclaim the gospel to more. So we can pray for openings in conversations, for Christians to share their faith, to explain the gospel, maybe to a family member or to a friend or a work colleague or a neighbor or even to a stranger, that the door of opportunity might open before us, that we might then speak to others about the Lord Jesus. What is Paul encouraging here in terms of prayer and evangelism? That we can pray, yes, for people to proclaim the gospel. We can pray for God to give people gospel opportunities, for Christians to be able to bear witness. And then thirdly, we can pray for people to proclaim the gospel clearly. That's what Paul says there, doesn't he, in verse 4. He wants his preaching to be accessible and understandable to others. He says, pray that I may proclaim it, the gospel, the mystery of Christ, the good news concerning Jesus Christ, that I might proclaim it clearly as I should. We can pray that when the gospel is proclaimed, that it would be proclaimed clearly. You know, next Sunday morning, we have a guest service here, James Muldoon. It will be answering the question, do I really need forgiveness? The following Tuesday, on the 29th of March, there's a women's coffee morning at the Oasis. Anna Taylor from Binfield Free Church will be speaking. How can we pray for these events? For what should we pray? Well, we can pray that people who are not Christians will come as they're invited to that guest service or to that coffee morning, that when they come, that they will be eager and open to hear the gospel, that they might be receptive. We can pray for James on the Sunday and Hannah on the following Tuesday, that they will explain the gospel clearly, simply, plainly, that God would give them the right words, that they might speak with fluency and warmth and boldness, that the Holy Spirit would be at work in the hearts and the minds of those who are attending, that they would listen, that they might respond to God's good news. We can pray for people to proclaim the gospel clearly when there's an opportunity for them to do so. So here, Paul is speaking about prayer for evangelism. prayer for those who have that opportunity to speak about the Lord Jesus Christ to others. But evangelism is not just about guest services and special events like Easter coffee mornings. All Christians are to be engaged in gospel proclamation. Every Christian should bear witness to Jesus Christ, not just by the words that we speak, but also by our actions. And that's what Paul comes to then here in verses 5 and 6. Let's think firstly about evangelism through actions. Evangelism through our actions. In verse 5, Paul emphasizes the importance of how Christians act towards non-Christians. What does he say? He writes this. He says, "Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity." Your actions towards others are crucial. Often they act as a bridge for the gospel. Through showing love and kindness, by expressing our concern and our care, in practical ways, we have opportunities to share the gospel with others. People are much more receptive to hear what we have to say if they know that we care, that we really do care about them. Because if they know that we care, then they're far more ready to listen. And often our actions, well, they establish the credibility of our spoken witness. You know, sadly, many people who are not Christians, they justify or they excuse their unbelief by the hypocrisy of professing Christians. They say, if that's how Christians act, then really I want nothing to do with Christianity. Now, sometimes that's simply a convenient excuse not to engage with the gospel. And after all, Christians, we're not people who are saying that we're perfect. No Christian is perfect. We do have faults and failings, and we've got to acknowledge those. The gospel is not for perfect people. But sometimes it has to be said that people have been hurt by the foolish and the unwise actions of professing Christians. And here we're being reminded that how we act, what you do, well, it speaks loudly and clearly to others without a word being spoken. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. We live in an age, don't we, that is very suspicious and skeptical of spoken truth claims. People doubt the public pronouncements of individuals and companies and even governments. We want those claims to be verified. How do we know that what they're saying is true? The same is true whenever we speak to other people about the Christian faith. How do they know? How can they have confidence that what we're speaking about is true? Well, one of the ways that they will assess that is to look to see how we live. Does believing this message really make a difference in your life? Is your life different in any ways because you are a Christian, because you're following the Lord Jesus Christ? The lives of Christians should be distinctive. Our lifestyle as Christians should be alternative. As Christians, we should be non-conformists within our culture. To live different and distinctive lives because we're following the Lord Jesus Christ. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders, towards those who are not Christians, because rightly or wrongly, they will judge the truth claims of the gospel by your conduct. And then look at what Paul says there at the end of verse 5. He says, make the most of every opportunity. Make the most of every opportunity. I wonder whether, like me, do you ever replay situations in your minds and you realize that you haven't made the most of an opportunity? Long after the moment has passed, sometimes I realize what I could or should have said, just to move that conversation on, to speak about the Lord, maybe to challenge something that's been said. With hindsight, I see that God had opened a door for witness before me. There was an opportunity to show love towards somebody who was hurting, or to encourage someone who was anxious, or to help someone who was in need, or to comfort someone who was distressed, but I didn't make the most of that opportunity. So many wasted opportunities litter our lives. Paul urges us we might be attentive and alert to see the doors that God opens before us, to see the opportunities that he sets before us, that we might speak a word of witness for our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe just through a simple action that gives opportunity to speak of the Lord Jesus. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Evangelism through our actions. But then in verse 6, Paul speaks about evangelism through our speech. What we say is important. Look at verse 6. Paul writes this: "Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone." We're always to be gracious when we speak to others. We're to deal with people in love. You know, the Lord himself deals graciously with us. And we don't deserve his love. We want to be like him. We're to be kind and gentle and patient in the way in which we address people and speak to people. Let your conversation be always full of grace. But such conversations are not to be without some bite. How does Paul express that here in verse 6? He says, also seasoned with salt. Always full of grace, but seasoned with salt. Salt is used in cooking to bring out the flavors of the food that is being cooked. So Paul here is saying that our speech should have some savor, some flavor. It should be zesty. There should be an edge to what we say. Our conversation shouldn't be bland and insipid and wishy-washy. There will be times where we should challenge unbelief and error and sin, because we want to speak truth to people. We want to share the gospel with others. We want to tell them about the Lord Jesus Christ. Let your conversation always be full of grace, but also seasoned with salt. It's quite a challenge, really, isn't it? For our conversation to be always full of grace and seasoned with salt. As time goes on, you realize that your mobile phone is recording more than you think it is. Or maybe that little device in the corner at home is recording more of your conversation than you think. Just imagine if your mobile phone, which is probably with you most of the day, is recording every word that you speak. And at the end of the day, you can listen back and hear every word that you have spoken. Or perhaps somebody else is able to sit down and listen to every word that you have spoken in the course of the day. What would their conclusion be as they listen in to your conversation? Would they be able to say that your conversation is always full of grace and it's also seasoned with salt? Notice what Paul says here at the end of verse 6. He says, let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Now, maybe you don't feel confident to initiate a spiritual conversation with a non-Christian work colleague or perhaps a housemate. Maybe you're apprehensive about speaking about Jesus to your friends. Maybe you're hesitant about introducing your faith when you're chatting to a neighbor. Well, I think that verses 5 and 6 here in Colossians chapter 4 are suggesting that if you are wise in the way in which you act towards those who are not Christians, and if your conversation is always full of grace and yet seasoned with salt, then opportunities will come. Your conduct and your conversation will compel interest. It'll prompt questions from those around you. And when somebody asks you the question why you act as you do or why you speak as you do, then you need to be ready and willing to explain to them what you believe or what the Bible teaches or how the Lord Jesus Christ has made a difference in your life. Be prepared to answer everyone who asks you, why are you full of hope? Why do you speak so graciously to others? Why do you show love and kindness and patience to others? Why are you a person of peace? Why are you a person of joy? So that you may know how to answer everyone. The Apostle Peter says something similar in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. Peter writes this, "But in your heart set apart Christ as Lord." You know, that's the very first thing to do. You need to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. You need to be wanting to serve Him as your Lord. You know, before your conduct or your conversation is going to be used in a way to bring honor to God, you need to be trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to come confessing your sin. You need to put your hope and trust in Jesus Christ. You need to set apart Christ as Lord in your heart. Set apart in your hearts Christ Jesus as Lord, says Peter. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give a reason, to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. See, Peter also speaking there about your good behavior, your conduct that leads to questions, that leads to opportunities to speak of the Lord Jesus. Well, we've had teaching this morning, Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 to 6, on prayer and evangelism. We're to devote ourselves to prayer. What will help us to devote ourselves to prayer? Well, if we're watchful and if we're thankful. How can we pray for evangelism? Well, we can pray for those who proclaim the gospel. We can pray that they would have great opportunities to proclaim the gospel. We can pray that we ourselves as Christians can have opportunities where God has placed us to speak of the Lord Jesus Christ to others. And when those opportunities come, yes, that we would recognize them and make the most of them, but then secondly, that we would proclaim the gospel clearly. That God the Holy Spirit would help us, just give us the right words and the right manner to be able to commend the Lord Jesus Christ to those who ask. We've been reminded too that we're all called, yes, to be witnesses to the Lord Jesus, and we witness to Jesus through our actions as well as through our speech, through what we do as well as what we say. We want our conduct to be a bridge for the gospel, to create those opportunities then that we might speak, that we would be ready and prepared to give an answer. When somebody asks us the reason for the hope, the peace, the joy, the love that we have, that we might point them to the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. May the Lord help us that we would conduct ourselves and that we would converse with others in a way that truly does commend the Lord Jesus Christ to them, gives rise to opportunities to speak to them of the Lord Jesus, so that they too might come to know Him as their Savior, and to serve Him as their Lord. Well, we're going to sing our final song. A song that really encourages us to be witnesses for the Lord Jesus, acknowledging that Christians are spread right around the world. We've been given this commission to go and to make disciples of people drawn from all nations. And so we want to add our witness and our worship to the witness and the worship of brothers and sisters right around the world. After we have sung, please be seated, and then I'll close our service in prayer. So when the music starts, please stand if you are able. Let's pray together. Father, we pray that as a result of what we have read in your word and by your spirit, that you would work in us so that we might be watchful, that we might be thankful, that we might be prayerful. We pray that you would help us, that we would see the opportunities that you set before us as your people to speak of the Lord Jesus. We pray that we would make the most of every opportunity to show love and to speak of Jesus. And we pray that when those opportunities come, that we might proclaim the gospel clearly. And we pray that what we say would be just made more effective by our actions, that we would show that we care, and that we care enough that we want people to come to know the Lord Jesus, to know him as their Savior, and that they too might serve him as their Lord. Father, we thank you for your grace. We pray that you would help us now, that we would go and grow in that grace, and that we would go and that we would speak much of the Lord Jesus Christ to those around us. Hear us and help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our service is over. We have a prayer meeting this evening, 5:30, meeting in the Kennett Room just downstairs here in the halls adjacent. Come and join us, 5:30 for prayer. And then our evening service at 6 o'clock, and James Muldoon will be here, God willing. And we're looking at one of the I Am sayings of Jesus, I am the vine, from John chapter 15 this evening. Thank you.